Westcast
Network. Our bitches start kicking ass, just like it said at the beginning of the program.
Man of the hour, tower of power, too sweet to be sour.
Sending your ass on the jabroni jet to the other side of the territory, brother.
The Alabama Hammer.
Nightmares on the best part of my day.
The goods from the woods.
Hot damn.
Welcome to the Goods from the Woods. My name is Rivers Langley.
Pat Riley.
This is a good man of the hour. Tap, pal. Too sweet to be sour. I'm on a satellite system. I'm on a laser beam system. I'm on a microwave system, daddy.
And now you're on the podcast system.
There we go. And today, our wonderful guest is...
Justin Williams.
Yeah! Hey. Freaking records! Damn.
Try again.
Or not.
Oh, my God.
Can I try one?
Yeah. Hey, and we're literally breaking records here.
What did you break?
Yeah, well, that was from another episode.
Yeah. Jimmy Swaggart.
Kind of a disappointing record, I have to say.
Yeah.
I know, it took three hits.
Yeah. It's durable, the well-made record, if nothing else.
Very, you know, for being...
Well, it's got to last eternity.
Yeah.
Well,
for being 80-point vinyl, that's actually 80-gauge vinyl. It's actually pretty good.
Not too bad.
Pretty strong.
People coming in here better wear shoes because there's all little pieces of vinyl all over the floor and all that shit.
I'll be totally worth it. I'll clean it up, but that was a lot of fun. I've never smashed a record before.
Yeah.
Well, apparently, according to Rivers, the trick is smash 78s.
Yeah, the 78s are easier to smash.
They're made of shellac.
I just feel like a DJ from the 50s quitting his job.
Rock and roll has got to go.
Yeah.
I'm not playing this Patty Page record anymore.
Ah, I still can't break it.
Wow, come these on, records buddy. Are no-selling Pat like the Road Warriors.
So?
This is the best podcast. I've already broken something and been applauded for it. I've spilled my drink. I'm smashing things.
It's wonderfully violent in here.
Yeah.
It's like a Gallagher show. Well, let's say, today the episode is going to be about religion.
I'm working on a building. I'm working on a building. I'm working on a building for my Lord, for my Lord. It's a Holy Ghost building. It's a Holy Ghost building for my Lord, for my Lord.
So you grew up Jewish or
sort of
Jewish, right?
I grew up with a very, very weird religious upbringing. My mother was raised Orthodox Jew, but it was also that post-Holocaust wave of American Jews where, like, being Jewish is just sort of a club you're in.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, you don't really have to believe in God. My mom is very spiritual.
It's an identity more than...
It's a cultural thing, much like Catholics to some degree during, like, the 1960s around Vatican II.
Like, you're good to other people, you know, if they're Jewish, because, like, you know, it doesn't matter if I don't know them. They're Jewish. You take care of those people. You take care of everyone. You're a good host, which actually is... one of the very, very few, like, actual religious things that shows, like, manners. It's a big thing when you're Jewish to be a very good host, be very accommodating, bend over backwards.
To help your
guests.
And I think that's fantastic.
That's like
it's one of the better things that I've picked up from
It's a great virtue.
Attitude of gratitude.
Yeah. Attitude of gratitude, exactly.
And if you ain't got an attitude of gratitude.
Fuck you. That's the way we live.
Oh, my God. That has to be a t-shirt.
Yeah, if you don't got an attitude of gratitude, fuck you.
Fuck you.
We coming for your ass.
Where it gets a little weird is, like, so she was raised Orthodox Jew, but when I was growing up, we celebrated Christmas and Easter. My mom made a huge deal of it. She said some of her family members are Jewish, like half the family. My dad was never very – him and I have never talked about religion.
Yeah.
And I'm not 100% sure what his belief is. I'm hoping he's an atheist, and I'm guessing he is.
Yeah.
Mostly because he's like, I just don't care.
Yeah.
He's an ER doctor. He's like, if I would hope that your ER doctor is an atheist because he's not thinking, well, if I screw up, I kind of did you a favor.
Right.
Kind of thought process. And then now she's in a Unitarian church, and one of our close family friends is a reverend of a Unitarian church.
Do they have Unitarians outside of New England?
Yeah, what?
Do they have Unitarians outside of New England?
No, they have. All right, so
they're rare.
I'll tell you this though: there's a Unitarian church in Auburn,
and they always have the best events.
They have the best events. There's a Unitarian church in Auburn, and the building that it's in was formerly a Black Baptist church. So it's in this very, you know, kind of clapboard, old school, you know, church with a bell tower and shit. And that was where my mom's family friend became a Unitarian minister. So we went there for a hot minute in like 1994, but they had the most badass playground. of anywhere in the whole town. They had
how they get you.
They had one of those rope nets, you know, those those like nets that would like go across from one tower to the other, so you could like jump off on and you just fall back onto the ropes and shit. But anyway, yeah. And then years later, the first time I ever got high and listened to Dark Side of the Moon was at a Unitarian Church event.
Well, that's what they're there for.
It was exactly. It was so good. But our family friend that is the Unitarian minister, the last time I went home, he's decided to grow his hair out, but he's bald. So he looked exactly like Benjamin Franklin. Benjamin Franklin. Like, not just a little bit. Like, he has the little tiny glasses.
He was a great American. Hair.
And that's how a Unitarian minister.
No, but he came to.
That's how a Unitarian marriage should look.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You have to have long. You either have to look like Mr. Van Driesen for Beavis and Butthead or Ben Franklin. If you're a male Unitarian minister.
He came to the comedy show that I did, and it was like a late show, and he was just sitting in the back. And fortunately, no one else noticed. I saw it. I said hey to him before the show, and I was just like, oh my God. He looks just like Benjamin Franklin. Dave Ross is gonna fuck with him. And to his credit, Dave Ross, neither Jared Harris, I don't think they noticed him. He was sitting in the back row.
Hey, did you come from time? This is messing me up.
Oh, God.
The Unitarian minister, my mom's place, actually looks like the little old man from Up. Like
Ed Asner?
Yeah, but if like he was spliced with Winnie the Pooh. So he's like a short, circular dude, but just has like this cute, lovable, like old.
And he wears nothing but a red sweater?
I wish. If I ever catch him in a red sweater, it's. His name's actually Reverend Ralph. He's like most adorable.
Is he named for Ralph Waldo Emerson?
Oh, I hope so.
He's the most famous Unitarian?
Yeah, but he's one of those dudes where it's like, you ever meet these people where like, you don't know their past, but it feels like anything you can think of would still make sense. Like every now and again, we were sitting around and he goes, my bees are doing all right. And we're like, you're what?
Yeah, but that's a Unitarian thing. You know?
Apiary.
A
shitload of bees?
Yeah, oh, and probably.
I bring jars of the honey back with me whenever I go home. That's the best shit.
That's good
shit.
God.
Bees that he control with magic.
I really
have you can control bees without magic. You just need a suit and hives and shit
and
like that.
A little bit of that smoke thing.
If I actually just saw him walking around doing this, like waving his fingers and clouds of bees were following it, I wouldn't be shocked. Like, he's that kind of dude. He demands that we refer to him as Your Eminence whenever he comes over, just like as a joke.
Oh, as a joke. Okay, I was going to say, that's amazing
if he
wasn't joking.
The first time he came over
he's
to
a king bee.
I'm an atheist, my older brother's an atheist, my younger brother is an atheist, but he also identifies communally as a Jew, actually has a Star of David tattooed on his back.
Uh-huh. Which is kind of ironic because they ain't supposed to get tattoos.
He actually used to design them too, so he made one for the family. And it remembers like my grandfather, who actually taught us a lot about my grandfather. My mother's side was an economy professor or economics professor. That shows how fucking smart I am. But he was also like really interested in like why people believe what they believe, where it all comes from, and just like a general obsession with belief. And he wrote dozens of books and hundreds of articles about it. And that kind of questioning nature. And my uncle on my mother's side was a prominent rabbi. And he actually apparently, I wouldn't say hung out with the Pope, but, like, was asked over to chill with the Pope and talk about stuff.
Yeah.
And so, but he was sort of an atheist, too. Like, you know, from what I'm told is that he just had sort of there's a God. But, you know, that's not the important thing. The important thing is – and so I was raised in a very openly spiritual household – in the middle of just fucking Catholic shit in Massachusetts, just a hellstorm of Catholicism and Protestantism and being a Jewish family but a free-thinking atheist in a small right-wing Christian town led to having some questions.
Which town was this?
Uxbridge, Massachusetts. Which
is that near?
It is near Mendon. It's the halfway point between Providence and Worcester. Okay. I grew up in Worcester, and then when I'm from Worcester, and I was in seventh grade. My family moved to because my mom works in Worcester, my dad works in Providence, so we found a midway point. And a lot of people just think Massachusetts is a very liberal, forward thinking. There are just these pockets of. I saw more Confederate flags.
Oh, Massachusetts!
In Massachusetts than I did when I went to college in the South.
You know how much
shit
I used to get for having a long hair?
I had a tan.
You'd think it was
and
the
it made
50s.
My life a nightmare.
Yeah. I had long hair and shit, and they thought it was like from Guns N' Roses or something. It was like controversial.
Well, at least you got like pseudo compliment out of that.
Well,
you
know,
like you could be a successful rock band.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. But because it was Massachusetts, so I used to just walk down the street and people would yell shit like nice cowboy hat f- and shit like that. I give him a fucking finger
every day. Well, I went to high school, very conservative area, very Christian area, and I was in high school when Massachusetts legalized gay marriage. And so my social studies class very smartly was like, we should discuss this.
Wasn't Massachusetts the first state to legalize gay marriage?
Vermont,
or was it Hawaii?
Vermont,
okay. Vermont has Vermont the civil Hawaii. Unions thing, because that's when they was doing that.
This is one of my better, one of the things I love about how the gay marriage got legalized and everything was when I was a little kid in elementary school, we had a teacher named Mr. Chalmers who was just think Guy Branum, but as an elementary school teacher.
Yeah.
That would be the most awesome elementary school
and
teacher.
He is, people are like, when the gay marriage thing was happening, like, how am I going to explain this to my kids? You don't. We just saw Mr. Chalmers skipping around the hallways thinking he's a silly man. He was the first man married in Massachusetts. Was a
oh, shit.
Teacher,
yeah.
Which I was very, very happy
I
for
have
him.
To say, I don't mean this in a bad way, but didn't they get divorced?
I don't know. I didn't ask.
That's what I thought I'd heard.
Well, don't rain on my parade.
Well, no, this shit makes the news. I'm just saying. They have to distract you from what's going on in the Middle East.
They got divorced, which is like, oh, good. You're like, this is a real thing now. Some people get married and they're
unhappy. Well, no, because that was a big story to distract what was going on in the Middle East at the time. Because it was one of them, like, Israelis killing
and we got into so many
Lebanese or something.
It was focused on way too much because it was also the same time that Iraq was starting up. And so some teachers want to talk about Iraq, which also coming from a conservative Christian area, that was fun to listen to.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That was I was in a debate class in high school in 2003 when that was going down. Oh, my God.
Which side did you get?
What do you mean?
Because you got to pick it out, right? Because it's just resolved whatever.
Well, no.
The side you get assigned.
No, well, we did that for other issues. But when it was going on, like, my whole thing was to have my actual point of view, which is a very left-wing liberal point of view. But then by the end, it just became more fun to annoy the liberals in the class.
Oh,
so,
my God. So
by the
fun.
End, I turned heel and would just, like, have these insane positions and just argue them just fervently.
Heel turn.
I did a real slow burn heel turn about the, you know, about halfway through March.
If it wasn't for me, brother,
exactly.
Al Gore would be selling meat from a truck in Minneapolis, dude, instead of me with Pasta Mania.
I was that way in a comparative literature class where they had us read Brokeback Mountain. Which the movie is a pile of crap, but the actual book's not
I thought
bad.
I liked the movie. You know,
I thought it was good. Really? Yeah.
The book is way,
I tell you why I liked
better.
The movie, because it had no special effects in it. And I appreciate that, because it is hard to find a movie that does not have special effects in it.
I hate to break this to you, but that scene with Jake Gyllenhaal and Heath Ledger fucking, that was all CGI. I've gotten into a lot of religious arguments, and I don't do it anymore because when you're a young guy become an atheist,
it's
a lot of fun, especially because, like, it's an easy thing to win because the only defense people can fall back on of any religion, of any faith, is faith. Like, well, that's my faith. Well, that's not an answer. Like, I'm not I try not to be a dick about it. I get very irritated when people want to control political issues and people's lives based on their view of reality, as skewed as it may be.
Yeah.
You keep your religions and your view of reality yourself, and I don't want to take that from anybody. I do want us to change the rules of engagement. Where if there's someone saying gay marriage can't be legal, women can't have control of their reproductive systems, we need to institute a Christian law in this country. And then when you say, okay, well, give us good reasons for that, they go, well, it's our faith. That's not a reason.
Well,
you need to have
evidence.
Well,
the third one that's the trick there.
Well, that's what freaked me out about the last election that no one talked about. It's what really freaked me out. Even Ron Paul.
But the Doe one, the Obama one,
the last Obama one that just happened. All of the people,
did you say the Dole one,
yeah,
the Dole one.
You've been hibernating.
Is that the last one? You
no, the Dole, because not too much shit happened.
Oh, Dole.
I thought you said Dole.
This election cycle is
just like Rip Van Winkle,
like John Morocco.
Just like
everyone on the Republican side, even the people that
I've been asleep for 15 years.
I have been asleep for 15 years.
Rumpelstiltskin
running for office, you understand.
But every single one of those candidates for the Republican side all openly admitted that they wanted a Christian government. And so no one was talking about the fact that if the Republican side won, we literally would have had a theocracy. And that's the
I think
a little thing called the Constitution.
Well, there's the
which
thing.
Does
well,
prevent
well and also
like
there's.
That.
You'd
they,
like to think it doesn't tell
well,
those
no,
people
the thing
in
is
charge.
They have to, you know, they have to play to their crazy constituency.
Their base.
Yeah. And well, then when they get in office, then that's when they have to.
See, that's if there's anywhere that I've toned down on my beliefs as far as politics goes, it's believing what people say.
Especially in the primary.
Especially in the primary, because people, you know. First of all, you have to think about the kind of person who would want to be a politician
but
in the first place.
It was through and through.
You've got to be fucked up
to want to do that job because it's
to get past the Republican primaries. You've got to say at some point, well, I'm not too sure on this evolution thing.
You gotta be crazy as fuck to win the Republican nomination in the first. Well, to even be noticed in the primaries, you have to be crazy as shit. So I take
especially in this cycle where it kind of swung very right.
Well, it's been
a Dole cycle.
Yeah, Bob Dole would now be a raving liberal. I mean, he's the guy who basically wrote Obamacare, right? Well, that was his solution.
That's what actually I felt a little bad about was like, I'm an independent, so I'll admit there are definitely people on the Republican side who identify as Republican that are smart,
yeah,
and can think of shit, and probably actually have been very helpful. But unfortunately, because we have like 24-hour news,
none of them are on the national fucking scene.
Yeah, because you need to be a lunatic to get noticed.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
So everyone who the Republicans picked was fuck nuts, insane, yeah, and highly incompetent.
Right.
And a perfect person to bring up, since this isn't so much about politics but religion, it would be Michelle Bachmann.
Right, yeah.
With her – and this was a thing that no one asked her that is very important, I think. She's very, very faith-based. I just listened to an interview with her today where she said if we legalize gay marriage, that the gay agenda is really –
that my husband will leave me?
Yeah. It's the whole, yeah, no one brought up the fact that her husband was like the gayest thing I've ever
right,
seen.
Right, yeah.
I've watched every Bob Fosse movie. Like this is the gay – She in an interview today actually said that the gay agenda really is to make polyamory legal and take away the age of consent so they can have sex with small boys. Actually said that on the air. No one said your husband runs those Pray the Gay Away camps, also known as suicide mills. What do you say to parents of children whose kids have killed themselves because you crammed down their throat that Jesus thinks you're a monster?
Well, if she had gotten further, I mean, that probably would have been the brick wall that she ran into.
Well, see,
I mean, the primary candidate is
she's 2.0, I think. She and Sarah Palin, well, maybe
she's
not Sarah
Palin 2.0.
No. I mean, she's like Tea Party, like Republican 2.0, in that there are the Republicans who are around, like John McCain is a fucking asshole, but he's still a guy who will say anything to win. You know what I mean? She actually likes the smell of her own shit. You know what I mean? She actually has bought into
mark.
It.
She's a mark.
She's
for
a mark.
The business.
That's great. Yeah, precisely. She is a. She's a goddamn. Yeah, she is a mark. She's a real mark. Everybody else, they know what's going on. They know how to play the game. She's like the next level of like politician
Santorum
that's really
a mark too.
Who is
Santorum?
Santorum's a mark. Yeah,
mark
weirded
too.
Me out.
Yeah,
and there was a minute there where he looked like there was a chance he was going to take.
Oh,
the
he'll
nomination.
Be back. He'll be back in 2 years.
Yeah, well, I mean, but that was such that was such a volatile primary because there was times where it was like Herman Cain was
Cain.
In the lead.
Oh,
and,
I loved that.
But it
man.
Was just like it was one of those things where it kind of gave an indication that like there was a complete disunity within the Republican Party between, you know, your classic conservatives, your compassionate conservatives, and your Tea Party types.
It didn't look like
and
it was
also
a
that there wasn't, and then they didn't have anybody that was a strong candidate on paper. And then also you couldn't have anybody that kind of, you know, it was Romney by default because he did have sort of
he was the white guy with gray sideburns who could stand up straight and, you know,
roll his shirt sleeves up
and not swallow his own tongue
8 seconds before saying something fucked up and hateful.
I loved it though. Oh God, I loved how. Have you seen Mitt?
I really want. I heard the thing with the iron where he irons a shirt while he's wearing it.
The oh my God, there's a documentary on Netflix.
Ironing his shirt. Well, I just imagine that scene in Taxi Driver where Travis Bickle has the salt and he just has it in his hand and he's draping it on the steak. I just imagine Mitt Romney just being like, you just got to make sure that it gets all the way on, you know?
There's a documentary on Netflix called Mitt.
Yeah.
And they followed him around during both elections. Like, it starts at the very end when he loses his bid the first time to McCain and goes all the way up through the loss of the 2012 election. And it's amazing because you do realize that he is also a total mark. He's not a lunatic, but he is also – he doesn't know why he wants to be president. That's the most amazing part of it is you're like, he doesn't – he just – he has no – it doesn't –
he just wants to be. He's ambitious.
But no, that's the weird thing. Watching it, you're almost like it's not raw ambition. Like he could just be a successful businessman.
Maybe he's just driven. He's just Mitt.
Or he could
the big time.
Or he could be like a many term like legislator in the
Senate. Yeah, he could still be governor of Massachusetts. Yeah. You know what I mean? I don't know if they have term limits or not. But
is Deval Patrick still the governor of Massachusetts?
No, it's another guy now, isn't it?
I don't fucking know. I moved.
Oh, wait a minute. Is he? No, I think he is, right? But they have a new mayor of Boston, right?
Yeah.
Well, they got a new senator.
Yeah, Elizabeth Warren.
Elizabeth Warren, who's great.
Who's cool, yeah.
Hopefully she'll get...
I was back in Boston not too recently, and I was sitting at dinner with my family. Thinking, you know, this isn't so bad. Why did I move? And then I looked over at a bus station where I saw a man punching his mom in the legs while they argued. I was like, oh, yeah. All of this.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of, not to segue into politics, I mean, everybody talks about how Hillary Clinton basically has the rubber stamp for the Democratic Party.
Yeah.
Which, you know, is probably true. But I think it is very interesting when you have the rumblings of, like, Elizabeth Warren
That's
maybe going into the primary, or Bernie Sanders going into the primary, which should be really interesting, too.
Yeah, I would love both of those things.
Hey, guys, how you doing?
Well, actually, it's not too...
That would be the first, yeah. Like, that would be the first president that I just want to cuddle.
Bernie Sanders.
I wanted to cuddle several. Chester A. Arthur.
Martin Van Buren.
Martin, yeah. The dude.
Taft, highly snuggleable.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He was like
I'm
a...
Grover Cleveland, gave good too. Back rubs. Clinton probably gave a good foot massage.
Well, no, there's a...
Abraham Lincoln would be good for the big spoon.
I had a... I had a professor actually in my program who knew Bill Clinton when he was at Oxford.
Oh, really?
When Bill Clinton was there on his Rhodes Scholarship.
Hey, look, have you ever seen those pictures of him where he has the red beard and the red hair? He looks like
Viking. Like, yeah, he looks like mini Bill Walton.
He looks like Leif Erikson.
Yeah. And he knew because I think his girlfriend at the time, the professor, was American, and all the American girls kind of lived in the same flat or the same section of flats. And Bill Clinton would always come by and just kind of, you know,
clean house,
wow Big them Bill. With his wow. Well, because they were all just like he. Like the thing was that the professor was like, yeah. When I met him, I was like, this is the most charismatic guy I've ever met in my entire life.
You know, people
life.
Spent way too much time bitching about him when he was president.
Yeah, no,
because he was fun, and them was the fun times. His appearance on Beavis and Butthead, for example, who could forget that?
Phenomenal, yeah.
Yeah,
that's my favorite joke.
Testies, 1, 2, 3. I love that joke. That was good shit.
Charisma, that we're talking about Bill Clinton, actually reminds me, huge part of it. If you ever watched like Ted Haggard, or any Pentecostal preachers.
Oh, yeah, it's all about the charismatic
Joel
Osteen. Yeah.
Joel Osteen, who I, for the longest time,
Joel
this
Osteen
is
just
true. First time I saw one of his books and he was on the cover, I was in Barnes & Noble and I go, Martin Short write a book?
Yeah, he cuts promos, man. Yeah,
even little churches, like little IFB, like Independent Fundamentalist Baptist churches. It's uh-huh. all the charismatic, the man of God. It's all just
believe,
a personality.
Well, it's charismatic authority.
With the pastor, yeah.
Believe whatever you want about these people and whether or not they're evil, despicable, disgusting creatures who are manipulating the weak. They are showmen, motherfuckers.
Yeah,
they are. Cares like even that.
We got a Jimmy Swaggart record right here.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. That documentary Jesus Camp, which is one of my all-time favorites, just because it actually does.
That's
take
horrifying.
It's horrifying to us.
It's the scariest horror
but
movie.
But it takes a really great objective look at it, and because I've shown it, I've watched it with friends of mine who are evangelical Christians. They're like, yeah, it shows us how great we are. Pastor Becky, who like is the one of the main subjects of the film, she's a middle-aged fat lady with terrible hair. And she owns a room. And the three of us are comics. Or four of us are comics.
Well, I barely count.
The four of us are comics, but we can respect the kill. You just respect the kill.
But the women pastors always get me, because they can be all fundamental about everything, but they don't open up that portion of the Bible where it says women are supposed to be quiet in church. They conveniently skip that direct command.
They conveniently skip a lot of shit. My absolute favorite thing that everyone seems to have forgotten, Jesus actually says, if someone doesn't believe in me, bring them in front of me and kill them.
Well, there's a lot of stuff in the Bible. It's inconsistent with itself. There's one part that implies that men are no better than animals, and neither of them have an afterlife.
Yeah.
Or my favorite part
is the talking donkey part.
Yeah, he talks to Balaam.
Yeah. But the thing that's interesting is that
waffles.
The Bible has a fantastic history to it. You know, it has as a document. They had to put in deference to royal authority in that because they have the part about the Hebrew women putting their children in the baskets and putting them in the Nile River. And they make the point in there that even though the end was good because Moses survived, the means of disobeying a royal is very bad.
Yeah.
So, I mean, so all those things kind of make their way through it. So it's kind of interesting as kind of – it's like a palimpsest. You know, you really don't – when you look at it at face value, you have all these sorts of things, but underneath it, you're just like, wow, there is so many, just like not just the religious aspects of it, but just like the contextualization, the
translation.
And it's such a
the sign of the particular time in which it's
and they all reflect the sign of the times.
The fact that it's the but that's what blows my mind, and I love the most, because the someone's religion is literally their view of reality. So for generations and generations at different periods of time, the immutable word of God, the truth, true reality was something completely different than what we know today because it had been edited.
But to be fair, it's not just religion like that. Science was the same way.
Science
people living in crystal spheres.
But science never goes, this is it, and this is all we're ever going to need. They go, this is what we found so far.
Wait, it does now. But, it, I mean, you know, the scientific consensus was a long time coming.
Right, yeah. Aristotelian through, science was, like, settled.
Yeah, if you go back through, even
up until
even
the Enlightenment.
Science was kind of like
yeah, that. No, well, Aristotle was the bottom line until Newton, who was the bottom line, until the Enlightenment when empiricalism
But, I mean, if you go back throughout history, people's worldviews are all dramatically different because of their religion, because of their culture, because of the different science. I mean, people in every different era have pretty much lived in their own universe, their own conception of it.
But I always find it amazing when, like, in modern society, when someone's like, "No, this is the immutable word of God. It cannot be changed."
Well,
and then, as you well know, it has been many times over.
Well, the funny thing about that shit is it's actually all relatively recent phenomenon. It goes back to a book in the early 20th century. Called our series of books, I believe, called Fundamentals of Christianity. Because you remember how you was talking earlier about like atheists and shit and how easy it is to win an argument? Yeah. It was a big thing in the 19th century. There was guys like the cool atheist, R.G. Ingersoll. He was a veteran of the Civil War and all this. It used to be real easy back then, because all you had to do was point out scientific inaccuracies in the Bible and say, no, you're supposed to take this literally. And in the 19th century, even strongly religious people all still believed in things like science and reason, because in those days that was a big part of being civilized. So you couldn't get around that. If you said, how can you make the world in 6 days? And look, if you look at this literally, it says days, not ages, and there was no answer.
Yeah.
But then fundamentalism come along and just basically says, we don't care.
Yeah.
We're just going to accept it by what it says literally. Doesn't matter if it doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
And that's actually a relatively recent phenomenon. It started in the early 20th century and actually gained a lot of foothold after World War II. So it's not like it's just some like ancient thing that's still around. It's actually a very modern, very reactionary phenomenon.
See, it's interesting because I went to Catholic schools and high school and things like that. And I it was interesting how in post-Vatican II Catholicism, those sorts of things are approached, because usually you know, 99% out of 100 times, people take it as kind of they don't take it literally, you know, so they create situations for, you know, science to work itself in, you know, because there is that very strong, like, scientific base in modern, you know, Catholicism with, like, the Jesuits. I mean, like, the Jesuits and things like that.
Oh, yeah.
And
Gregor Mendel.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. All those.
Who discovered the science of genetics was an Austrian monk.
Yeah. So there's a sort of thing where we were taught in religion class where it's like, no, these are not days. These are, you know, you can actually map along the course of the world was created, and you can put the dinosaurs in there, and, you know, man is at the end, and you can presume some sort of evolutionary process or something like that. So they actually go out and say there's strict interpretism, you know, literal interpretism, and then there's kind of contextual interpretism. And it was always interesting that it was presented in that sort of way, so that even at a young age, so that when I kind of encountered that for the first time in real life, it was something that was kind of a bit of a shock, where it was like, well, I was in this religious situation and people were not like, oh, this was a literal interpretation. So I always found that very interesting whenever I saw that.
They're not young earth creationists or any
of
that stuff.
But that's actually he's very much right. Actually, evangelicals pop-wise did not become a big thing until the 70s.
Yeah.
With all the Left Behind books, and they became big into popular culture.
And the Born Again movement and everything.
And they got a lot of foothold just in the 70s. And so, like, yeah, a lot of people who were, like, being raised, like, in religious households, like, were like, yeah, these are stories that teach you how to live your life. And I have my own issues with that, because the actual New and Old Testament are full of just the most evil, vile shit I've ever read. And I read a lot of evil, vile shit.
I don't like – there's lots of parts of the Old I just outright don't like. When they kill all the Egyptian kids, I ain't buying that.
But the problem –
Well, that was Nietzsche's favorite book, so.
The problem that's coming up now that I've noticed is kids aren't given that choice. Of like, here's what, because where I was raised, it was like my family is like, yeah, a lot of people believe different things, and you're just going to encounter that. I went to a trip to the Creationism Museum, which I've talked about at length.
Oh, the one in Kentucky?
One in Kentucky. I actually almost brought a photo of me and my ex in front of their little green screen where they have like an ark and then one with dinosaurs, and we thought it'd be funny to act out the opposite one and make them print that for us. But what really freaked me out when I was there, not only is it very obvious this is aimed at children, like your concepts of size. So they have a whole exhibit about the ark, and they've built a chunk of the Ark. And the measurements of the Ark in modern day terms is like 300 feet by 50 feet. So, but when you're a little kid and you see a 50-foot tall thing,
yeah,
you are amazed. You're like, yeah, of course animals can get on that. And when I saw parents with their kids, this is really where I got irritated, aside from when they said Jurassic Park was bullshit. I really got so
mad. It real, though.
I got so real. Mad. They kept bringing up, like, in Jurassic Park, they said this. But I'm like, you're not a scientist. Shut the fuck up. And Jurassic Park is one of the greatest movies ever. But when...
It's still real to me, damn it.
What you've done with your dinosaurs and your puppets.
He's a man.
What freaked me out was when they had an exhibit, instead of a parent looking at their kid and go, see, Billy? Well, God's creation, wonderful. They would look at the kid and go, and that's what happened. Like, they would, you know, and it freaked the fuck
out.
You
know what always bugs me with that shit is when they do that bizarre Kent Hovind shit where they have this thing with, like, dinosaurs being on the Ark and dinosaurs coexisting with man and being in the Bible.
Yeah,
and
it's like, look, photo I've ever gotten. You know, riding Triceratops with a saddle on it.
Yeah, no, so that's the thing. It's like, look, this shit, this dinosaur beside man is not supported by the Bible nor science.
Right, right.
So you're not picking either side accurately.
Which historical figure probably had the coolest dinosaur to ride? I'd say Hammurabi.
You know what? I would think Charlemagne. I can see him really going down.
Charlemagne would just be rocking it with, like,
Charlemagne was a bad dude, and he had an elephant and all that, and that might as well have been having a dinosaur in Europe.
The way they explained it in the museum, and I thought this was hilarious, was they're like, well, you never hear the word dinosaur because we didn't have a word for dinosaur yet. But the next thing you see is Adam in the garden, this very detailed diorama, this lifelike, you walk through it, and there's Adam, and he's naming the squirrels and the rabbits, and right next to him is a T-Rex. I'm like, you didn't think to name that anything?
Yeah.
Well, I guess he didn't have a working knowledge of Greek.
Or he couldn't just look at it and go, all right, I'm going to skip the small fuzzy animals. Let me name the 20-foot monster who's eating a pineapple.
Yeah, well, they try to claim, like, Behemoth is a dinosaur, but it's clearly like a hippopotamus or some shit when you read the Bible.
Right, right.
Behemoth.
And Leviathan. Let's not forget that. That thing's badass.
But that's like a whale.
Yeah, but none of those are
dinosaurs. Oh, no, it's
dinosaur.
It's a great fish.
Yeah, yeah, but yeah. None of – well, they couldn't tell the difference anyway because I think birds are bats.
Yeah, because they're dumb.
Yeah, but there's no dinosaurs in the damn Bible. They should –
There's
they,
none.
Yeah.
But
not,
it's
not
just
a matter
way to
of misinterpretation.
Justify. Well, because people – I don't think people who believe in any real religion but have a certain faith are by default stupid. You can be a very smart person and believe something that is fuck nuts insane. You really can. If you're raised with it or just something happens to you and you're like, you know what, now I'm going to follow this path. If you're smart – you can rationalize anything to yourself. So when they created young Earth creationism, they're like, well, we have all these dinosaur bones. We can't argue dinosaurs aren't real. No, we coexisted and they died out like 2,000 years ago. Remember how they talked about dragons? Dragons.
Yeah,
those were dinosaurs.
Like, it forces one to subscribe to this alternate theory of life on Earth, which ain't in the Bible and ain't in history either.
Yeah, you would think we would have found
Think this would come up more. And they go all over the place. Like, they find, like, you know, these old, like, Roman mosaics, and they see, like, a poorly done hippo or leopard or something and claim that that's supposed to be representations of dinosaurs and shit like that.
Yeah, it's
my favorite dinosaur is Ultimo Dragon.
I'm a big Supersaurus fan. But
that's a good dinosaur.
And even like
my
when they
dinosaur is Mick Jagger.
And even now when they try, like, especially the Creation Museum, to have the dinosaurs, all of which they modeled on the Jurassic Park models of dinosaurs. Now science is showing us that dinosaurs had feathers.
Right,
oh, no,
right.
You know,
so
I'll
they're even screwed up on that.
That's where Goodnight cashed out on dinosaurs,
yeah,
by the way.
Probably all had feathers. Let's just be honest about that. It's like that, you know, people, they get like, it's like with the steroids and baseball thing. Everybody believes that their favorite player didn't do it as long as it doesn't come out yet. And everybody believes that their favorite dinosaur didn't have feathers until it comes out. But if one of them had feathers, let's face it, they probably all had feathers.
I'm just saying, like, yes, dinosaurs had feathers. However, I don't want to see it.
A feathery T-Rex is the worst.
But see, look, that's a willing suspension of facts that don't fit any worldview.
To not ruin the next Jurassic Park movie. That's the – I'm not – here's
Already ruined.
Oh, no. I don't know. Chris, did you see a picture of Chris Pratt? That's my new man crush right there.
Well, no, I'm just saying I was told a little bit about what the plot
I
possibly
was.
I was
too.
Ooh, if that's true, it's going to be fucking rough.
I'm very curious. But
it's going to be rough going.
But the – like, yeah, it's a suspension of fact to hold on to belief that I'm admitting is fictional, whereas instead of suspension of observation to hold on to belief that is detrimental to other people – and I'm saying is the absolute truth. Like, you people who, like, faith, I don't understand why faith, and not just Christian faith, not just Jewish faith, not just Muslim faith, faith in general, why we applaud that behavior in people, by definition,
well, really
is the denial of reality to hold on to
really
a belief.
It's only religious people that do it, that yep. use it as a virtue. But, I mean, you know, you got to do something to get through the world, because it ain't easy.
Up above my head.
Up above my head.
I hear music in the air.
I hear music in the air.
Now up above my head.
Up above my
you
head.
You know I hear music in the air.
I hear music in the air.
Up above my head.
Up above my head.
I hear music in the air.
I hear music in the air.
And I really do believe.
Yes, I really do believe that
there's a heaven somewhere.
So many people, you know, claim a religion because you want to be part of the club. That's what so much of it is. It's like most people just kind of go and nod their heads and don't think about it because they like the community aspect of it. Like we were saying at the beginning of the show, like there's plenty of people that I know from where I'm from that go to church, but they're not like bad people. They don't necessarily agree with it. It's just like, well, you know, this is where all my friends are on Sunday. This is a place where I can go wear my new shirt.
Yeah, it's a part of culture and shit.
It's part of a culture.
And again, if you live in an isolated place and shit, it's a way to meet up with other people.
Well, no, that's the thing. Yeah. It's like if you live in a place too long, you'll just eventually like, yeah, I guess I'll go see what the Methodists are doing. And then you kind of fall into it. Whereas if you're doing... you're doing comedy or some other art where there's other people involved.
You're going to start doing
coke
at some point.
Well, you'll just start that. That's how you meet people, you know.
No,
so
or you could take up
that's
bowling.
Who your world is. Yeah,
yeah, that's what your world becomes. So if you're, you know, if you're just living in a small town somewhere, you're like, well,
yeah,
shit.
It's a form of civic engagement.
Yeah, it's a way to meet. Yeah, it's a way
that's
to
how,
exactly.
Because I had a lot of questions about the Unitarian Church because as it was kept being explained to me, I was like, how is this not just a tax dodge?
Yeah, yeah.
And they were like, look, it doesn't matter what you believe. It's just everyone's right. I'm like, okay, this is some bullshit. But it's like, you know what it is? We a group of people come and hang out. Everyone cooks a little something.
Yeah.
You play with some kids. You have a
you're
nice time.
You're supportive of
like
each
the
other.
Like the moose.
Which is not a bad thing. And I'm not against.
Yeah, I'll just join the Elks Lodge, though.
Yeah, the moose.
Yeah.
Shriners.
I would never Shriners. Take away.
Thomas.
Get to ride the little car.
Yeah, and wear a fez. God. I'm all set.
If churches gave
I'm never
going to
do
it
without the fez on.
Although, do you got to be Catholic and be a Shriner? Or was that
do
Knights
that.
Of Columbus? Do you got to be Catholic and be Shriner?
Knights of Columbus, you got to be Catholic.
Yeah, that's kind
Italians.
Of the... Yeah, that's kind of... The Knights of Columbus was the more sort of conservative end, like the moral conservative end of the Catholic Church for a long time.
Oh, but the Shriners, though. Do you got to be Catholic and be Shriner?
No,
that's like a that's like a civic group, right?
Yeah, that's like the
that's
Masons
a free-for-all,
and the
yeah,
and
not
the
a civic group, I guess,
and,
but yeah. Like
yeah,
the fraternal organization.
Fraternal organization, there
I thought there might have been some religious aspect.
No, they just picked up like the aesthetic of North African sort of garb and Turkish, you know, loosely Arabic.
Well, I know
it
has like the Middle Eastern aspect to it, but I didn't think it was like a Muslim thing. I thought that it might have been some kind of Catholic.
No, they just did that because I think they liked, you know, they thought the duds were groovy.
The fezes are cool.
Fezes
are
awesome,
really
undeniably so.
I have one.
You have a
Who
fez?
Doesn't?
Yeah. Shit, I want a fez. My mom's an antique broker, so we come across a fair amount of Shriners like stuff. And I've never found a fez that fit my head, but she
Mine
has those
doesn't.
Like
no.
those crazy
I don't
elaborate
think they
ones.
Have to.
Well, I, you know, they have to fit a little bit.
You don't want to have to wear bobby pins.
Yeah. Right, I don't want to pin
That's
it to my
head.
Yeah, when I'm smoking my pipe and reading my...
bobby
pin
it on.
Oh, I could never bobby pin on. Our hair was always... We'd always get a haircut for go seeing your family in Great Neck, so they'd give us yarmulkes, and just every 10 seconds I'm just patting the back of my head like, is
Are those is anybody, serious, or is that just like a dignified way to cover up a bald spot?
That's what I always assumed it was.
I
look
do
at
have...
Jewish genealogy, there's always a...
Because sometimes even the Pope wears them, and I don't think he was a Jew. He was Catholic, I think.
The Pope's hat crazy. The Pope wears what the Pope
wants
to
wear. Well, they're big on hats.
Wear.
It's part of the office, is having big hats.
I do have a question. All right, so
Tiaras,
when you're bald and you put the yarmulke on, does anybody ever use double sided tape?
No, you know what?
Is that against
that
the rules?
Someone has done.
Do they make
it
adhesive
on
ones? Because you know they make like the stick on bronze stuff. Do
no,
they make a stick on
just,
yarmulke for a bald head?
You just need to put it on that exact right spot where your head starts to curve back, so
and the hair
just,
will
kind of
keep it in place.
Yeah. But if you're bald. And just like
if Stone Cold was going to Temple.
I know. If Goldberg.
If Gorilla Monsters. Yeah, it's just.
Goldberg.
Goldberg. Yeah.
If Goldberg was going to a funeral and they had to be outside,
maybe he would have gotten some spirit gum. I'm not saying it's never happened, but I haven't seen it.
Yeah, and it's like windy and shit. It's a funeral, and he's got to stick it to his head.
It's hard to keep them things on your head.
Yeah, dude, especially if you're Goldberg.
It is. Yeah.
Goldberg walking down the aisle, like giving his daughter away at a wedding.
With the cops.
With the cops.
And the sparks.
And they would play the music, and the sparks would shoot. He's walking down the... And then at the last second, the rabbi hits him with the stuff.
They had temple priests.
Hey, yo.
The rabbi is Scott Hall. He hits him with the stun gun.
Let me tell you about the Torah, man.
When I was a little kid and they dragged me to temple, if there was wrestlers there doing that, you'd see the most devout Jew.
Oh, yeah, of course. Me too. Shit, I would convert immediately. Oh, yeah.
Well, it was interesting because my father... My grandparents were they were very tight in the community aspect of the church, and you know they were believers. And,
right.
My father, when he was in his 20s, he went to a Black Baptist church for a wedding.
Yeah.
And Mathalia Jackson was singing there.
Oh, shit.
So he not only got the black church experience, which is it's like the polar opposite of the Catholic church experience.
Oh, yeah.
But then you throw in Mathalia Jackson. It was just like, he was just like, why wasn't I in that faith growing up? Because I would so be into
that. Oh, yeah. No,
that's actually part of the reason my mother is the way she is. When she was very young, she had a black nanny that would bring her to a church like that in Pittsburgh. And that's her favorite type of music is gospel.
That's good shit.
It hooks you. Just that.
Dude, it's a fantastic. I mean, it's a fantastic.
Go back to the social aspect of church, because for a lot of time that was all they had.
Yeah, exactly.
Church.
It's nice to have a social thing, and it's nice to have something you can fall back on. Like, I'm sure we all know people who have gone through recovery, or gone to rehab, gone to prison, and they fall back on faith, and they fall back on their religion. And I would never want to take that away from someone. Whatever you need to do to get through the day.
Yeah.
Whatever you need to get through the day. I'm fine. Do what you want to do. And I say this, like, I fall back on one of the greatest philosophers of the 20th century, Elvis Presley.
Yeah.
Do what's right by you so long as it ain't hurting nobody else. You could do whatever you want in the privacy of your home. You can do whatever religion you want. And you can even just say to me, like, hey, I'm a Christian. I don't give a shit. I don't care as long as you're not a dick.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just don't be a dick.
Yeah.
That's all I'm asking.
Well, you know, traditionally it wasn't always about that, because there was usually a latitude for different opinions even within certain religions.
But inherent in any religious belief, inherent in any of them, is the idea that you are right and everyone's wrong. I know the truth. You don't. And that's one of my own personal pet peeves. It's not like a big philosophical one, but I get super irritated with that self-righteous smile you get when you're talking to her. It's like, I told someone I was an atheist, and she just sort of smiled and went, so far. Dude, I'm going to say this publicly, whoever hears this, I don't care what I went through. I don't care how I got to this point. If I come to you and say, let me talk to you about the Lord, and I mean it, fucking shoot me in the head.
Because
I've officially lost everything that has made me, which is actual thought, free thinking, being objectively just staring at things in the world, loving science, loving the world, loving the planet. If all I care about is getting to some clubhouse in the afterlife,
yeah,
fucking kill me.
Although if the clubhouse was – see, I flirted with Methodism briefly in the late 90s. And
John Wesley.
And if the clubhouse
was a man.
He was a hero to the poor.
Wait, that's John Wesley Harding.
John Wesley Harding.
He was a friend to the poor.
Yeah.
With a gun in every hand.
They actually have one of John Wesley Harding's guns up in the Autry Museum.
Yeah, he wasn't nothing like in the Bob Dylan
song. No, he was
song.
A murderer.
He was a bad
dude. He was a
dude.
Vicious criminal.
Yeah.
I went to the Auburn United Methodist Church. Had MYF, which is their Sunday Night Youth Foundation or whatever, and they would have free chicken fingers and honey mustard.
Ooh,
and everybody got to play GoldenEye projected up on the
are you serious?
On the wall.
Oh,
so they had two N64s each hooked up to
that's a path to righteousness.
Yes, it is.
Oh, my God, salvation.
I'd go do that now.
That's an attitude of gratitude
right
there.
So they would have GoldenEye. They would project GoldenEye up on the walls of the church, and everybody would play GoldenEye and eat chicken fingers. And then afterwards, they'd have the devotional where they would come out and talk about Jesus and shit. The boring part. They had pool tables. They had a basketball hoop inside. It was great. But the day I stopped going was the day they held up my science book from 7th grade and just went, this is a book of lies!
Oh, when they get into that shit.
I was like, oh,
well, no,
God.
You know, that wasn't always a big part of going to church.
That's terrible.
What I don't like about,
that's
like,
the thing.
Modern
is, like,
shit.
You keep saying, like, hey, it wasn't like this, it wasn't always like this. Well, the problem is that it is now.
And well, because there's so few people left. That's why.
When we're in an era where you have nuclear weapons.
Yeah.
Like, everything's going banana shit in Israel right now. When you're in a world where... almost all these religions think that this is the end of days and they can fucking make it happen.
Yeah.
And even if it's not the end of the days, miseducating entire generations of children and teaching them that critical thinking is a bad thing, we're all gonna die.
Yeah, well,
unless people give up.
Well, theoretically,
their
we all are anyway.
Yeah, but here's the thing that about today is you have so many people. All right, so I'll put it this way. Like,
wait a minute, I'm gonna die.
There was
yeah, everybody.
Oh
is.
Shit!
Dun, dun, dun.
You learn it here.
No, no.
He just runs through the wall.
The weight of mortality is heavy on people.
I'll put it this way: the two like, you know, popular dystopian visions are of 1984 and of Brave New World. And in 1984, it's like, you know, fascism takes control of absolutely everybody. And you know, and it's a hard edged fascism, and then in Brave New World, the fascist is a soft edge where they allow everybody to like just sort of gel into their own narcissism. Huxley is gonna win out on that one because that's
Huxley was brilliant.
Hell yeah, because that's what happened. We are in a
if
self-
anything just for the name Mustafa Mond. Yeah, I think that name is so awesome.
So we're like entering into this
better
this
than
zone
Big Brother
of just self imposed narcissistic fascism that we've brought upon ourselves. And of course,
capitalist.
I'm a comedian saying this into a microphone on a podcast, and I'm so guilty of it. But that's where we're heading. The actual religions, the people who are into it now, are super into it, and they're going to die into it. But after that, I mean,
we're just not going to notice that someone sent the bombs. That's all.
Well, that's the thing. But even after those bombs explode, people are going to survive, and eventually those people will just sort of devolve.
Survive.
Yeah, we're all going to live, guys. It's all, we're going to live forever. But everybody is eventually just going to become their own god.
Mormonism? This is confusing.
No, not Mormonism. I'm just saying.
We got to talk a little about Mormonism.
Mondism.
That shit is so funny.
Yeah, but I just think at a certain point, the need, because the community aspect of religion will be the only appeal left of it after a certain point. And even that will have to go away because everybody is connected immediately at all times.
Yeah, like you have pretty much religion, my issue with it when you get to the community aspect is the same thing happened to you at the Methodist Church. We're like, this is fun. There's Goldeneye. There's cake. There's pie.
Here's this ulterior agenda.
There's just so much fun. By the way, your Uncle Jerry that likes to sing, yeah, he's going to burn in hell forever.
Right, right.
By the way, your girlfriend has to have that baby. Doesn't matter. They're only 16 years old. Also, we did tell you not to use condoms, but that's not really our fault. But we're still a fun group, right?
But I don't know.
Religion had its place. It needed us. Yeah. Actually, the
it
first
ain't gonna go away
point.
Though. It ain't gonna go
oh,
away.
It'll never go away, and I don't
because
want
life
it.
Is, but it's too much about suffering. Yeah.
No, it won't go. It won't go away, but it'll just become less threatening. I think.
I would hope so. That's
well, you know, they go
helpful.
In. They go in waves, and sometimes the tide's in, and sometimes the tide's out.
Yeah. Point is, I'm not super worried about it.
I'm more worried about the shards of really sharp vinyl that are all over the fucking. I found one of those in my hat for fuck's sake. I wasn't wearing it when they were breaking
just
records.
Don't roll on the floor naked, and you should be fine.
Shit, well then there goes my fun. You know what I'm saying? If I can't roll on the floor naked, ritual. It's not any place I want to live.
When burdens seem to overcome that higher power, who's faithful and refuses none.
We just mentioned the Mormons. I always thought the Mormon planet Kolob might be kind of a cool, like, metal band
Kolob.
Name.
Kolob.
I like that. Like, Ivan Kolob.
Well, there is no Mormon, like, heaven. God lives on a star base called Kolob.
Oh, can't say it ain't scientific.
That's what I love. It's like Mormonism and Scientology. It's like, this is just science fiction, and it's awesome. I mean, of course, Mormonism waited until the 1962 to stop telling people that Black people were
devils.
Oh, yeah,
they couldn't get into the church. Yeah. Well, they've changed that because they got all them Samoans in it now and everything.
they got to get somebody in there. Have you gone into the at least the visitor center?
No, Riverside has.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I went in there with a buddy and
it's a beautiful building.
It's a great place.
Talking about the Scientology Center?
The Scientology Center. Oh, let's just talk about Scientology Center because if you've ever lived in LA and you haven't gone to Scientology Center, you are fucking up.
Oh, I've been.
That is a blast.
I'm fucked up.
Oh, it's great.
Though they'd want me if I went in there, though. I don't know if I should go in there.
Just go to get the free test, the little e-mirror thing, because I don't know about you guys, but if I pay attention, I can kind of raise and lower my pulse, and that's how they work. So you can really screw with those people if you can drop it down and then raise it back up. You just think of a beat. like just really focus on a beat and kind of like meditate on it.
Rhythm is a dancer. Rhythm is a dancer.
I'm serious as cancer when I say that rhythm is a dancer. I love that song. I love that song so good.
Let's hear it now. There it was.
Wow. That's a good one.
Wow, Snap was amazing.
I went into the Bass. L. Ron Hubbard Museum, uh-huh, not realizing it's an hour and a half tour.
Oh, jeez. They like to pretend like he's not dead sometimes.
They also like to pretend that his life story makes any sense. Because I've always fascinated me is when I went in there, if his whole life story that he's told everyone, he is Johnny Quest.
Yeah, he goes on adventures. He's Batman. He's like standing next to a biplane wearing a scarf with goggles and shit.
Well, he was big on boats and shit.
Well, he was big on all stuff, but he was also a drug addict, a whiner, and a racist bastard.
And a failed science fiction writer.
Well, he's pretty successful. He did all right as far as science fiction.
Well, he did all right eventually. Yeah,
Dianetics.
Dianetics by Ron Hubbard.
I used to wonder what that shit was about. The commercial. They used to have those commercials.
It's just which is volcano. Volcano.
Yeah. No, they used to have these ones like with like a guy in a sports car, and it's like, this man has everything. He's got money, he's got wealth, but he's not happy. And then they'd be like, find out and read Dianetics.
Dianetics by L. Ron Hubbard.
Yeah, with the volcano on it. But I was like, what the hell is this shit about as a kid? I'll be honest with you. I had no clue all this crazy shit Scientology was up to until Battlefield Earth came out.
Well, you got to donate a lot of money to get to the level where they even reference that stuff. Because if you talk to any Scientologist anywhere, they will deny it up and down. I actually got super lucky. This is scarier than the whole aliens thing. I got my hand on a book they give to children for the classes for auditing. And they did something that a lot of religions do, but this one does it the scariest, is they're kids. So they have some of those big words and a little header and then a little note on you saying, this is what this word means. They would start changing the definitions of words to fit what they meant in Scientology.
Oh, Jesus.
And the idea that with Scientology is it was described to me on this tour, because when you do the L. Ron Hubbard tour, it's all about his life. And if you have Google, it's all horse shit. And I knew it was, but I didn't want to be a jerk to this girl. Which, by the way, all Scientologist women seem to be weirdly hot. I don't know what it is.
They probably put them out front.
Because there's a huge sort of tie-in with Scientology and actors.
Aspiring actors or failed
actors.
That's I talk about that because when we went,
that's kind of mainly who Scientology.
Yeah,
is.
Because there's a couple of interesting foci when it comes to. Scientology. One, Scientology is incredibly connected to the entertainment industry.
Yeah.
So there's like this sort of thing where, you know, there are ties in with casting agents and things like that.
Yeah.
But two of the big sort of draws for people that are in Scientology is people that are former drug addicts or are current drug addicts.
Narcanon is a huge, it's like right up there with AA when it comes to that.
Yeah, and then the other one is there's a heavy level of homophobia within Scientology.
Yeah.
Or at least, you know, as it's been presented to me. And there's a lot of people that go into Scientology that are gay and they want to get away from that.
Yeah.
You know,
Tom Cruise, John Travolta.
Tom Cruise and Tom Cruise and John Travolta thing. I mean, there's always been rumors about like Will Smith, for example.
Yeah.
The interesting thing about kind of with Scientology is that Scientology has this incredible amount of blackmail behind, because you're supposed to share these things as part of it. So, you know, they have your, you know, innermost skeletons, and if you
it's like the Riddler in Batman Forever.
Yeah, if you turn on, you know, the
great literary reference.
Exactly.
Fuck yeah, bro.
But if you turn on it, essentially they basically blackmail you and say, you know, if you turn on us, we will unleash all of these things
getting blackmailed from a lot of the stuff that I've seen, because I got obsessed with Scientology for a little while. Blackmailing is like the low end tier. There's a lot of like unsolved murders.
Oh, fair game.
Yeah,
a lot of unsolved murders that like they're like, there was no way this was an accident or a suicide. This person, like, you know, was boiled in their bathtub, and then they go back and they go, oh, this person was in Scientology and trying to get their money back.
Yeah, because there's a lot of, it's interesting because,
like the Masons.
Well, because living in Florida, you would hear stories in the news about it, like, coming out of Clearwater, Florida.
Starving people to death and shit.
Well, no, there would be a murder or somebody that was found that was deceased in under very weird circumstances in Clearwater, but then it just became a thing where you wouldn't hear anything
bloody
about
water
that story.
on Cinemax this fall.
Oh, man, I wish y'all could see the look on Ripa's face.
It's as terrifying as you think it is.
It's like Bray Wyatt.
Sister Abigail.
He got the whole.
Is Scientology huge in Florida?
Yeah. They basically have a lot
Does
of.
Does that surprise you, though?
Well, no, because no, they have a lot of they have a lot of real estate holdings because there is a lot of money that is in real estate.
Their biggest center on the East Coast is in Clearwater, Florida.
Yeah.
Oh, shit, that's right.
Yeah.
That's whenever I think of Florida and religion, I always think about the Holy Land, which I still have to make.
Oh, the Holy Land experience.
I've been there.
I've still got to go.
No, it's interesting. You know, I mean, as just a cultural sort of.
How are the shows?
They're interesting.
I bet you them Jesuses get tons of ass, man.
Seriously. They must. They have to. Because, like, the Jesuses that I've seen, like, they're good-looking dudes. They can sing, they can dance, and they're famous, and
big,
they have
tall
that crazy confidence.
And he's Jesus. And on a commercial, they even have him come up there, and he goes, come. And I'm like, I would.
I did.
Yeah.
I will say this before.
This is wild tonight.
I will say
it.
This before we get off of Scientology. Okay, so the two interactions I've had with the Church of Scientology. One, I went there with another comedian, and the whole time I decided I was going to just do a bit. So I decided I was like, I'm going to do this character of, because the whole thing is they're trying to get people off drugs, you know? And so I was like, I'm going to do the most stoned, sober guy. Like, I'm going to be a guy who sounds fucking high as shit, but has never done drugs before. Mm-hmm. So I just, like, went up and I was talking to the guy who, by the way, like you were saying, all the girls in there are very good looking. All the dudes look exactly like me. So I was talking to me, and I was just, he was just like, so, like, what brought you out to California? It's just like, I was like, I mean, you know, I'm a seeker, man. Like, I kind of just, like, want to do everything, you know, and truthfully, like, I've experimented with Christianity, I've experimented with Islam, and now I find myself in Hollywood, and you know what? I think America's unique because we don't really have, like, a godhead or a monarch. You know, what we've got is those big heads on the silver screen, man. Those are our gods, the celebrities. And where do they go when they need help? They come to you, man. They fucking come to you. So now I'm here trying to get the answers for America's godheads.
If you took out 2/3 of some of those lines, it sounds like something word for word that David Lee Roth would have said in an interview.
Did they give you the meters with the tin cans?
Yeah, no, they did that later. We had the personality test.
Did he pull the tin cans with that?
Yeah, no, they do that later. That's a separate thing. There's an e-meter reading.
Don't tell you anything. They're bullshit.
They're bullshit. Okay. That's an e-meter reading. That's different from the personality test.
Is that your thetans or some shit like that?
The e-meter measures your thetans. The personality test just tells you which class you have to pay for. Basically, like, where you're fucked up and how to correct it.
They just gauge how much they think you can reasonably afford.
And if I tell them, like, I'm having trouble taking a shit, could I have thetans up my ass?
You have to take the BM classes. Yeah. But I did that shit for this guy, right? And he was just like, so where do you work now? I was like, I'm a chef, bro. I make food that makes people happy. And he was like, and I was working at the grilled cheese store at the time, so it was kind of true. And the guy was like, do you have any problems with drugs or alcohol? I was like, nah, bro, never touched the stuff. I've never been high in my life. And just, like, continued doing this weird thing. Meanwhile, it's Reza Asghari, former guest on the show, is next door talking to the hot girl. And he goes, oh, yeah, we're both, like, stand-up comedians, you know, we're just in here just to see what it's about, you know? And I'm fucking over here in the middle of this, like, the best acting job I've ever done in my life, just fucking owning it with this idiot.
Don't break kayfabe, man.
I know, yeah. So
kayfabe to the grave.
That was my first interaction.
He exposed the business.
He did.
He's like Vince McMahon.
The second interaction I had, I was scrolling down Facebook, and there was a comedian that we all know who had ad for it was Roscoe's Chicken and Waffles comedy show at the Celebrity Center.
I remember this.
And I was
right
just,
next to where I live.
Yeah. And I was just like, fuck yeah, Chicken and Waffles, are you kidding me? And I get to go be at a weird the Celebrity Center at the sign. Fuck yeah, let's do it.
Cool.
So me and Joe Rains and Nick Thomas go.
Joe Rains.
And we had to like make.
Guys, I don't understand what's going on.
Dude, we
fried chicken here?
Yeah.
There's no fried chicken. We gotta get the fuck out of here. And,
so we go and we get down there, and, you know, we're all from Alabama. If there's fried chicken in the room, we all fucking know
was
it.
The argument, was the argument just Joe going, I'm not going. They have chicken. I'm going. The whole
there was a few I'm more going. I'm not goings in between there, but essentially, yes. But
you don't have to be from Alabama to get the appeal of fried chicken. I would
no. But what I'm saying is that if it's in the room, I know the smell. So we go into the Celebrity Center and we walk by. We go through the back, and in the back of the Celebrity Center, it's on Franklin, right across from UCB Theater. In the back of the Celebrity Center, they have a cafe where anyone can eat. If you want to go eat back there, you know, you do so under your own judgment. But if you want to eat back there, you can. So we walk by. There's a couple people sitting at tables eating. We're led inside by the Scientology police. We have to tell them, oh, we're here for the comedy show. And so they lead us downstairs, and they go, oh, the comedy show's in the Marionette Theater downstairs. So we're like, we're all good until we start going down the stairs because the entrance.
The Marionette Theater.
Yeah, the Marionette Theater.
How much of that do they have?
It's fucked. I'm getting there. We're going to get to the theater. We're going through the lobby. It's very nice. And then they open this like steel door, and we start going downstairs. And when you go into the basement, there's no more windows. There's no way to, like, you know, the safety that I feel that I could jump out of a window at any time, you know, and get away.
Well, it's a basement.
Is gone.
I mean, if they had windows, it'd just be dirt.
Right.
Be looking at worms and shit.
But there's no escape. So we're going down, and now I'm getting creeped out.
You have to fight your way out, Reverend.
I have to fight my way out, and we're going down the stairs, and immediately.
Go in the bathroom and, with me.
That sounds like fun. You have to fight your way out of there. I like this.
We're going down the stairs, and I immediately, I'm just like, there's no fried chicken here. I know there's none in this building. And then Joe's just like, it's lies. It's all lies. And we fucking walk into the Marionette Theater, and I swear to God, it's this tiny, tiny little theater. And there's all these like weird Comedy Store comics that I don't know. They're all kind of hanging out in the hall, and they're not weirded out by this at all. And I'm just like, I don't know how these guys are even doing this. And we walk into the Marionette Theater, and they're playing like circus music. And we're like, oh God, this is fucking creepy. And then we sit down and Joe Raines turns to me and he goes, my seat is warm. And I was just like, and I was like, are you fucking serious? I was like, we gotta go. We gotta fucking go.
Were you guys high or something?
No, I wasn't. I mean, Joe probably was, but I was sober as a judge. I was just like, oh fuck, dude, we gotta. And I went in the bathroom and like took a good look at myself in the mirror, and I was just like, no, you're not brave enough. We gotta go. And so we came in. I just fucking walked out. Now here's the freaky part. We were in there for maybe 6 minutes, and we start leaving. And on the way out, we go back by the cafe, which previously had been populated by people eating. There's no one there, and all the chairs have been packed up. And I was like,
there was no chicken anywhere.
There was no chicken anywhere. And I was like, oh my God, the whole thing was a ruse. Like,
not even waffles.
We fucking ran.
Not even Pit Bull energy drink.
Yeah, no Pit Bull, no chicken. So we literally like ran out of there. It was terrifying. I ran. Yeah.
Was there audience?
Huh?
Was there any audience?
It was a little bit, but I did notice. Oh, I
some
did
marionettes, perhaps?
No, I did notice on the way out that they were offering a Scientology stand-up class, and
I've seen flyers for those.
I kind of want to do that.
I want to go so bad.
I kind of want to take the Scientology.
Yeah, which
kind of
falls in line with like the like agency sort of thing.
Yeah,
Thetans.
I might get representation.
Yeah, I know.
Who knows?
I actually the playing the character thing. I've done that for the Scientologists, but I did it with a friend for the Mormons. This is the reason we're such good friends. We went on a walk. And we said, "Let's go to the Mormon Center." They get the whole big opening spiel. Don't even look at each other. We just start holding hands. And the whole time we came in, we were talking about how, like, we know your stance on marriage, but he was raised Mormon. My family was sort of into it, and I fell out of it. We're kind of interested. So very nice lady asked us questions and just sort of gritted her teeth through every dumb question we had.
Right, right.
And there's one thing she said that I will never forget, because it wasn't – because she did at one point give us the whole marriage between a man and a woman thing very angrily.
Right.
But there was one thing she said that I don't think she understands how fucked up it was. They show you a video in the visitor center. You go through like a series of videos, and you follow this family sort of going through the years and how being a Mormon has made their family better. And being a Mormon looks awesome. They go hiking all the time. They play baseball. At one point, Grandpa –
they all look good.
They all look so good.
They never age.
Well, apparently the point of that is you have to look really good and well-groomed so you can sort of convert people and bring them in.
Yeah, but they never age. I can't figure out how they do that.
It's they just sleep in Tupperware.
I guess so. Maybe because they weren't drinking soda or something.
In the fridge.
So there's an episode where Grandpa dies, and she's explaining to us about how, like, you know, the family was shown this way of, like, what we do with the souls you see. So Mormons, and this is actually not true, but what she said to us was, see, the Mormons believe is that, you know, your soul doesn't go up to heaven in a way. Mormon God hangs on to your soul. And it's like, you know, those jars of butterflies. So Grandpa didn't go to heaven. He's in a jar right now. And then she goes, and we didn't poke holes in it, so we can't get out. I was like, are you really going to tell children, hey, Grandpa's in a jar and he can't breathe?
He didn't poke holes in it. That was going to be my question.
Yeah, she's like, yeah, when she said we don't poke holes in it, I was like, oh, I'm going to lose. There's no way I'm not going to get to that laughing.
They don't poke holes in it. That's horrible.
That was my question. Like, you don't? He's like, yeah. I was like, we don't want to get out.
Even for a thought experiment.
Can't breathe.
That doesn't sound like fun.
Yeah.
But Mormon heaven, this is the whole reason they're actually against gays, or at least they say it is because Mormon heaven is you get your own planet.
Yeah.
And you get to govern your own planet. And you have to populate it. That's why you get so many wives. You have to populate the planet. So if you're gay, you can't populate it. I got to tell you, they need to start letting gays into Mormonism because that planet sounds awesome. No kids. Highly gentrified planet.
Yeah, just two dudes chilling.
Yeah. Just two dudes and like a wonderful, comfortable place.
Yeah.
No children.
Yeah, well lit, like clean streets.
Yeah, it's just not going to be well populated, though.
Yeah, no, that's great. Yeah,
I don't like the idea of having one's own planet.
Yeah, a whole planet of just West Hollywood? Fine.
I want to convert to the Mormons or something because I want my own planet, but then you can't drink or anything, right?
Yeah, that's the... You
can be the rebel Mormon.
Yeah, it's all juice bars.
I want to bring this thing up real quick because I watched it yesterday. I saw the title alone on Netflix. It is the greatest name for any documentary I've ever seen. Wrestling for Jesus, The Story of T-Money. It is about a Wrestling for Jesus league in South Carolina. The guy who started and made it big, T-Money, I thought this was kind of funny. He decided to be a heel. That's what he wanted to be.
So do the heels like cheerlead for the devil?
That's the thing. They had one guy who was sort of satanic, but in general in this documentary, they never mention like any of their political associations or how they feel about like sin or anything like that. But what you see is a really awful wrestling match with a bunch of out-of-shape dudes and then an altar call. And I'm going to spoil the documentary for you guys because I thought it was hilarious. 99% of it is just like, because I'm doing this for Jesus and I love the Lord. The Lord saved my life. And they got biker guys in there who are like, I'm truly a better person because of the Lord. And I'm truly better because of the wrestling. And I really appreciate this. Then this line, which is my favorite. I wouldn't say I was addicted to painkillers. I did about 40 of them in one day, though. Even me, I was like, wow, that's a lot.
That's a fuckload.
So T-Money got addicted to painkillers, chokeslammed his wife while she was pregnant. The ending as a happy story is happy because he met another woman. So everything's fine for T-Money.
Was this like Benoit or some shit? Why was he chokeslamming his wife?
This whole documentary is about how great of a guy says at the end. They're like, by the way, he chokeslammed his wife while she was pregnant. But Jesus is the best part. It's a really great documentary.
I would like to go down to that faction and work like a Dennis Kucinich heel angle. You know what I mean?
You know, there's a decent amount of it. I think it's just like DiBiase used to run it and all that.
Well, I know DiBiase is
you put on a wrestling show and.
Well, I know. Yeah, DiBiase is like a big Christian or whatever. But like, how do you
what
are the heels doing? Like, what are they doing?
It's just a general, like, I'm going to take the belt from you. It's just
from my impression, it's just sort of like if they were putting on, like, a concert or something.
Guys.
It's just a regular wrestling match with a regular heel, and maybe the face is
which means you can get married by the million-dollar man, Ted DiBiase.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
you could get married by Sting. You could get married by
Shawn Michaels.
You could get married by Lex Luger, Nikita Koloff. Tully Blanchard. Yeah.
I want to see a Sting.
That would be amazing.
He drops down from the rafters and shit.
I would prefer a Surfer Sting wedding.
I want a Joker Sting wedding.
Oh, God. That was the weirdest.
With the guard bird.
The magpie? It's not a crow, it's a magpie.
As
not a crow, it's a magpie.
As Brian Alvarez would say, a guard bird.
he said it's like Alfred Hitchcock's The Birds. These things, they go for your eyes and they just pack away at them.
If anybody has any objections to this union, it'll go to you and pack.
He turned the water into wine in the little Cana town. The word went all around. Turn the water into wine. He turned the water into wine.
Justin, where can people find you on the internet, sir?
On Twitter, jwilliams1701.
I know.
Think of another one.
JesusSaves.com.
Change it immediately.
Someone took the one I wanted,
like
which was
316 or something.
I love Jesus.com.
I didn't think I was going to use my Twitter account ever.
Yeah.
JWilliams 1701.
What's the 1701?
It's a Starship Enterprise call.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah,
NCC-1701.
I didn't know he's a big fan of that.
I'm a big fan. Actually, this is a true story and one of a joke that I do with stand-up. Just tell it real quick. I wanted to get the callers, the Enterprise, tattooed on my forearm. And my mom said, I don't think your relatives who survived the Holocaust would really appreciate that. And I said, tell them it's for a movie, Shatner's List. Also, I host a weekly and a monthly show in Westwood at O'Hara's Bar. And I would like actually to have a Goods from the Woods night when all the college kids
come
back.
Yeah, that'd be a great time.
That would be fun. And what's the show called?
A Very Special Episode.
All right, everybody. Follow us on Twitter at TheGoodsPod, Facebook.com/TheGoodsPod, on YouTube.com/TheGoodsPod. And right now, this is a song by the Drive-By Truckers. This song is called Too Much Sex, Too Little Jesus.
Too much sex, too little Jesus. Ever since she's 12, she felt foreclosed under her and thought she needed help. Listening to the radio on a Sunday night, she heard the preacher calling out to call upon his helpline. It sounded so nice, sounded so inviting. For a small donation, she could have the Lord Almighty. She told him her story, he told her his thoughts. He said you better fix yourself right in the eyes. Smoking, stop that masturbation. Take the Lord into your heart and stop that fornication. We're building us an army, gonna knock out Satan. Is there a MasterCard or operators waiting?
The Goods from the Woods is mixed and edited by me, Rivers Langley, and distributed by Westcast Network. Our theme song is composed by DJ Smiles. You can find him online at djsmiles.net.